Okay, well, welcome everybody to another one of our little podcasts. Today, we're going to be looking at video compression 101. And I got it down to hex of 65 the other day. 65, I suppose, not 65, is it?
What, 101? No, that's only about 5, isn't it?
So, as we compress things, and in fact, we're bringing this to you via the joys of video compression, Phil's going to explain to us just how that works.
So this was going to be a preliminary for the podcast I really wanted to do, which was all about modern picture quality analysis nowadays, where we're worried about things that happen in the temporal domain. So we're worried about things that happen over time. Back when thee and me were just starting out, the only thing we really worried about was video levels, because you could be pretty certain that if a video circuit could pass a single line of video, then it could pass a single field and a single frame and many seconds of video. And it's only as we've got into not only digital video, but digital video where we're not sending pixels, we're sending mathematical descriptions of what we'd like the pixels to look like. It's only when we've got to that stage where we have to start worrying about things that happen in the time domain. Typically, video is delivered based on what we call a long-GOP, a long group of pictures compression system. And so, a frame may get through fine, a frame of color bars may look splendid, but when some really complicated moving, action pictures start being put through the link may well fall over. And so the thing we're trying to get to after today's podcast is how we test for that, how we measure the performance of a link, be it a network link or a fiber optic video link. With that in mind, we're sending compressed pictures over this. Does it do the job? Satellite links particularly, it's something I've been having to deal with recently, because they're all compressed. But I suppose really as a grounding to that, we have to talk about compression. Compression's been around forever, really since the late 80s was when very clever people like MPEG, the motion picture expert group, largely out of the Fraunhofer Institute, started to devise ways of not having to send every single pixel, but rather send mathematical descriptions of how to rebuild those pixels at the other end. We have video compression. We almost never deal with uncompressed video. And that's because, even a standard definition uncompressed video signal, 270 megabits per second, that's fine going from the camera to the back of the VCR. But when we want to do things with it, like store it on videotape or send it across a network or store it on a hard disk for editing purposes, that's just too voluminous a data rate. There's just too much there to be able to sensibly do things with that. So compression is a fact of life. There's only been two videotape formats that weren't compressed. The venerable old D1 from the late 80s, and then D5 from the early 90s, although D5, when running in its HD mode, is compressed. So very little video that we deal with is uncompressed. For the most part, everything is. And we'll talk a bit about that today. So, okay. If we're talking about kind of, old industry veterans like you and me, we remember when video was all analog. When the signal that came out the back of the camera traveled down a cable, into a VT or into a vision switcher or something like that, it was an analog signal, whereas the voltage on the cable was describing how bright the picture was instantaneously at that moment, or how colourful it was instantaneously at that moment. And that might have been an RGB, three separate signals, or YCBCR, the two-colour different signal and the black and white luminance signal, or it might have been a composite signal with the colour subcarrier providing the colour fill-in, on the same cable as the luminance signal. But of course now, since the early 90s, pretty much everything we deal with has been digital video.
Yes.
And so before we think about digital video, we have to think a little bit about how we make a digital bit stream from an analog signal. So up on screen now, I've got a little very rudimentary waveform, a single cycle of a sine wave. But they always use sine waves to demonstrate this, because a sine wave is, as Mr. Fourier tells us, the simplest signal we can conceive. And so there you can see we've chopped that signal up in the time direction into about, it's probably 20 samples. And in the vertical level direction, we've chopped it up into 16 discrete levels. So there we've got a system that's kind of sampling. We don't know how long this waveform is. We don't know how much time that is. But it's sampled the waveform many times over its period. And it's sampled it at 16 levels in the vertical direction. So we'd say that would be a 16 level or four computer digits to encompass that signal. And I'm not quite sure what that signal is. It might be an audio signal, but But 16 levels for an audio signal would be a very poor system. You know, that would be a very bad dynamic range. The audio would sound awful, worse than a phone line. But just really to sort of to bring this back to video, for standard definition video, it turns out that to faithfully reproduce video, we have to sample at least 256 levels of finesse, and we have to do that 13.5 million times a second for the luminance signal, and similarly 13.5 million times a second for the colour difference signals. Remember, they're stored at half the data rate of the luminance signal. That's why we have 422 video. Not, well, there is 444 video, but for the most part, 422 is what happens most in television. And so
the 4 is a multiple of the subcarrier, is that correct?
It was when we were dealing with what we called 4FSC composite video, but there wasn't much there. There was a couple of videotape formats. D2 and D3 were both composite systems, but the nomenclature carried through to component video, and so the 4 says 4 samples of luminance, and then 2 and 2 CR and 2 CB samples that go along with those 4 samples of luminance. Yeah. So it turns out that for standard definition video, we need to sample the signal 13.5 million times a second, twice, and that gives us a 27 megahertz clock rate, pixel clock rate, and although 8 bits is kind of adequate for delivery, 10 bits is really needed if you want to do clever things like get chroma keys out of video and things like that. And so most standard definition uncompressed video we refer to as 270 megabits per second. Yeah. That's what an uncompressed standard definition system would record. We don't do much uncompressed work, but that's what it would do. Yeah. Now for HD, there's 6 times as many pixels. So, you know, quick kind of crude, you know, calculating up for HD, it's 1.5 gigabits per second for 422 video. But if we're going fancy and we're moving up to 444 video, then it's 3 gigabits per second. And as we start moving up towards, you know, blinking 4K and 8K, we're starting to talk about 6, 12, 24, 48 gigabit per second video. So you can see that these are just phenomenal data rates that don't go across networks. They, you know, they don't go over the air. You know, they're not usable in any sort of way, shape, or form. So compression is a fact of life. There's just a little slide there that shows you the 422 structure, where you have 4 luminance samples and the CR and the CB are co-sited with the first luminance pixel. Then you have a luminance pixel without any chrominance pixels along with it, and then another one with CR, CB. So there's the 422 structure.
Yeah.
And you know, that Rec 601 standard definition digital video standard comes from 1982. And it talks about 4x3 video. Oh, you know, that's not really used much anymore, is it? We're all widescreen now. 720 by 576 pixels, which is sufficient for our 5.5 megahertz analog signal, and YCBCR luminance stroke color encoding 42. But, you know, pretty quickly, as the 90s wore on, we wind up with 16x9. And if 4x3 gives us non-square pixels, which it does, then 16x9 gives us very non-square pixels. And the color space, that 422 color space, and the sampling structure, they're entirely unlike graphics formats. They're not like TIFFs or TAGAs. But, you know, when this was all being thought of, you know, no desktop computer could run Photoshop, for example. So you can kind of forgive them for not having, you know, caught up with that. And there's just a little slide there that shows the various iterations of SDI, I suppose. And it was always viewed as being an extensible standard, you know, that started off, at 270 megabits, and we now find ourselves in the 1.5/3 gigabit kind of range for most contemporary television.
Yes, as a matter of interest, I don't think I've yet come across much 3 gig stuff, perhaps because I don't circulate in the hallowed circles that you do, but...
Digital film, it's used a bit for digital cinema, but you're right, given that 1080p, so 50 or 60p video, has yet to land, has yet to really, you know, be taken very seriously. There's not much of it. I mean, Sky do it a bit. There's only one VTR that can handle it. That's the HDW5800, the Sony machine. Mm-hmm. All cameras and matrices and all equipment can do it, but it's just, I mean, it's twice the data rate, isn't it, for a tiny percentage of people who've got the right set-top box to display it. So, you know.
And it's, it will come, maybe.
Yeah. So there's a little slide there just showing you, you know, where we came from in computer video terms. There's a little screen grab version one of the QuickTime player from the early 90s. And all those early kind of computer video systems, again, entirely unlike the video that we use today. So RGB for their color representation, square pixels, varying in frame rates, you know, 12 frames per second and up. You know, just not what we're used to dealing with. So enough kind of intro to digital video. I'm sure we did a podcast, didn't we, a couple of years ago about that. So we should refer you back to that. But video compression, how does it work? Well, to start with, we have to remind ourselves that there are two forms of video compression. There's what we call intra-frame encoding, which exploits the fact that there's lots of similarities within a frame of video. There's huge, great blocks of color that don't change much. There's bits of very predictable content within a frame of video. So that's called intra-frame encoding. And then there's another sort of like redundancy we can exploit called inter-frame encoding. That's the differences between frames of video. We can exploit the fact that not much goes on. Most videos are locked off shot of a talking head, you know, so not much goes on between frames of video. If you go into the average facility, most video is just frames of color bars that don't vary at all.
That's true.
And so the guiding principle, the thing that all this video compression is based on, that the mathematical kind of recipe, if you will, that starts all of this compression off, is the discrete cosine transform. It's a bit of quite heavyweight maths, which we won't go into excessively. I'd have to kind of get a book out and refresh my memory because it's quite heavyweight. But basically, you have a predefined a DCT matrix, this thing that's chopped up into red blocks here, and you use that as a reference point, and you basically, so if you imagine here, we've got this bit of picture matrix here. This is an 8x8 block of pixels that maybe this is a very, we've zoomed in on a piece of video, and this is maybe the glint in somebody's eye. This is a very, we've zoomed right in, and we're only considering the luminance portion of the signal for the minute, because Chrome has done as well, but we can just assume this is a tiny bit of the luminance portion of a video signal, 8x8 macro block. And so there are some sort of like typical values for the video down there, you know, sort of like we've got some bright bits there, sort of 40s and 50s. I don't know what kind of, you know, scaling system this is, but you know, down there we've got the sort of very low values for the blacks, and a bit of sub black there as well. Look at that.
Negative. Yes.
Yeah. But what we have to do as our first step in our discrete cosine transform is we have to turn that from pixels that represent brightness on the screen into what we call DCT coefficients, discrete cosine transform coefficients. We're not throwing away any data at this point, and we could, all day long, we could happily flip between pixels, DCT coefficients, back to pixels, back to DCT coefficients. No information will be lost, and no quality will be lost. You know, that would be an entirely transparent system going between pixels and DCT coefficients. And so the way that the DCT transform works is that it basically examines each pixel and all its surrounding pixels to derive a kind of an amount of busyness within that part of the picture. And it does it by referring to this piece here and looking at how similar the bit of picture under consideration is to here. And it derives a number from 0 to 64 relating back to this matrix.
So that matrix in the red with the black and white material behind it, is that a reference?
Yes,
as it were, a
reference matrix that basically allows us to go between pixels and DCT coefficients.
So
the DCT coefficients, you know, because of the way the transform works, you always wind up with higher values up here and lower values down here.
It basically describes
the frequencies, the energy, the amount of busyness, the amount of differences there were within that block. If it was a block of pixels that were all identical, you'd have the initial pixel value there and nothing else within the whole matrix. As it stands, you have lots of high numbers at the start of the matrix there at the top left. By the time you get to the bottom right, there's not much going on at all. And this might give you a clue as to how we can then start compressing. Because essentially we're using something called a run length encoder. A run length encoder is a bit of compression technology, very simple, that says it looks at each pixel as it comes along, and it compares it to the ones that have been previously. And if it sees a long run of pixels or any bytes of data that are the same, it says, I'm not going to send 10 bytes of data all value 10 or all value F2 or whatever those hex values are. I'm going to send the first one, and then I'm going to send a run length indicator that says, repeat this 10 times, please. And so you can see that with sort of sequences that where you have you know, several values occurring together, you can start getting compression. You can start getting, you know, we can throw away amounts of information and still retrieve everything at the end. And so, if you remember, that's what the DCT coefficients look like there, and then what the run length encoder in a compressor does is that it starts at the top left there and does a kind of zigzag walk through the matrix all the way to the bottom, and run length encodes as it goes. Now it turns out that with camera video, if you just do that, you can get nearly 2-to-1 compression without throwing away any information whatsoever. It's how DigiBeta works. DigiBeta is a 155 megabit off tape format. And have you ever seen a DigiBeta compression artifact?
Probably not. No. You can.
Well, yeah, you can with proper test equipment, but to my eye, I've never seen a DigiBeta compression artifact in 25 years of watching that stuff. 20 years of watching DigiBeta material. Just relying on the run length encoder, you can throw away almost half of the data, safe in the knowledge that you can recreate that data again because you've used the run length encoder. Now, the other nice thing about using the zigzag walk in the DCT compression system is that if you say to yourself, if your compression management system says, well, actually, I need you to compress this a bit more than 2-to-1, I need you to compress it 4-to-1. So at no point can you ever get any further than a quarter of the way through the zigzag walk. By doing that, stopping the run length encoder a quarter of the way through the zigzag walk, so only 16 steps into the 64-byte block, and just disregarding what comes after it, actually, it looks pretty good, you know? And that's how, essentially, things like DigiBeta works. That's how inter-frame compression that doesn't rely on dropping information between the frames of video, that's how it works. It basically divides the picture up into macro blocks, does a DCT encode on each of the macro blocks, and does a run length encode, and chucks away what it doesn't need or what it doesn't want under the guidance of a compression manager of some sort, something that's saying to it, we've only got this many kilobytes for this frame of video, you're going to have to kind of take real liberties here. And it's how JPEG works. So there's some JPEG frames there. And you can see those first three, which are compressed 3-to-1, 15-to-1, and 25-to-1, they all look quite splendid, you know. I mean, the last one on the top line there, the 25-to-1 compressed one, if you look hard, it doesn't look quite the same as the first two, but it doesn't look bad, it doesn't look objectionable. When you get to 50-to-1, you can start to see the edges of macro blocks creeping in, particularly in the shaded areas of the picture. When you get to 150-to-1, well, you know, that's kind of unacceptable, isn't it? You can see every macro block edge, and we really have run out of any detail in the picture there. But hey, 150-to-1, we've thrown away all bar less than 1% of the original data load, and it's amazing that it's still recognizable as a piece of stone surrounded by leaves with JPG written on it. You know?
Yes, it's amazing.
Quite staggering. So that's, if we stopped at that point, that would be what we would call an iframe compression system, and most editing systems stop at that point. They don't take any more liberties. Yes, and what we have there is we have, although it's a compressed stream, each frame of video is complete and in itself, and you can edit it, and you don't have to undo any kind of sequence to make things work together. And typically, you know, for HD edit codecs like DNX, Avid's DNX codec or Apple's ProRes codec, typically 10-to-1 compression is invisible. And people edit, you know, 145, 155. Sometimes you really want to push the boat at 185 megabit per second video, about 10-to-1 compressed on the original 1.5 gigabit per second video stream. So that would be great if all we had to do was edit. But of course, we don't. We have to be able to deliver video. We have to be able to do things that require an awful lot more compression. We don't have 150 megabits of data space on a transmission multiplex, for example. They're all typically 38 megabits per second coming down from the Astra satellite, coming from the Freeview MUX at Crystal Palace, those kind of things. You know, we have considerably less data available than that. And if we're talking about YouTube deliverables, you know, we're talking, even good quality, we're talking 1-2 megabits per second most. If we're talking about the iPlayer, 1-2 megabits per second. And so we really have to be able to compress a lot more than just an iframe codec would allow us to do. So
it's just worth, just with that figure of 1. Whatever megabits per second, just looking back a little bit and saying how many bits did we have to represent per second for one frame of broadcast video? And it was around about the 1 megabyte per second, wasn't it?
Yeah. Oh, 1 megabyte per frame.
Per frame, sorry.
Yeah,
yes,
yeah. Per 25 megabits per second. 270 megabits per second.
Yeah. So, you know, just to sort of picture how much magic we're doing here.
Oh, it boggles
it's
the mind.
Exceptional.
Yeah,
it really does.
Absolutely. So we now have this principle of interframe compression, where we're taking liberties between the frames of video. Now, half the work's been done already. We've already encoded each frame of video into macro blocks. And the real power of an interframe compressor is that it relies on those macro blocks. So this is a screen grab from a piece of encoding software, which allows you to turn on and show what's happening between the iframes. So clearly, the iframes, which are complete, admittedly compressed, made up of macro block frames, but they are complete frames of video. And then we have these other constructs in between called B and P frames, which we'll get to in a minute. But here's my compressor, and it's showing me what's happening to the macro blocks between frames. So each one of these little white lines is called a vector, and it's showing us how much that macro block moved between frames of video and in what direction. So a very long white line means that the macro block moved a decent amount between frames of video. A very short white line, or in fact a dot up here, you can see in the background here, you see dots, yeah? That tells us those macro blocks haven't moved at all. And so for non-iframes, all we do is we send vectors. We say, you know that macro block back there in the previous iframe? You know, it's the same macro block, it's just moved a bit in this next frame of video because the camera was panning or subjects within the image were moving. So those macro blocks have moved. Now, clearly, stuff happens, stuff comes on and off screen between iframes, and that's where you can see these grey blocks here. So this is, I can tell you, this is a P frame, so it's a predictive frame, and most of the macro blocks, it just reused from the previous iframe, but 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, about 20 macro blocks had to be made fresh new because either bits of the picture were revealed that weren't in the previous iframe, or things moved too quickly, or you know something happened that put too much extra information into the picture that meant the encoder had to generate something in the order of 20 or maybe two dozen new macro blocks for that P frame. But for the most part, that P frame is just recycling old data from the previous iframe, and these little white lines show the vectors associated with each one of those macro blocks and how they've moved. It's a splendid idea, you know? And so we wind up with this concept of a motion vector detailing how macro blocks move with respect to the previous iframe. And during the decompression process, when you're replaying those pictures, so long as you've got that iframe that came before, you can say, okay, all we have to do now is track those iframes using these vectors to see where they went. Now, as playback decompressors have got much better, the motion estimation algorithms and the way we track how the vectors tell us those macro blocks have moved have got so much better. And so a contemporary MPEG-2 playback decompressor, so like maybe something from Main Concepts or something like that, from today, from 2014, will play back material and make it look a darn sight better than it did in the mid-90s when Hewlett-Packard were first starting to produce transmission servers and people were first starting to implement MPEG-2 systems. So even with material that was encoded 20 years ago, you play it back now, it looks better than it did 20 years ago, just because the people have got better at writing decompressors. They got better at hiding the macro block edges when we've overcompressed and things like that.
It's extraordinary, isn't it?
So there's a little bit of a history thing. MPEG-1 from the early 90s was the basis for CDI and video CD. You remember those? Yeah. They were kind of early DVD predecessors. Very limited, though. I mean, it's 4x3, only had stereo audio, only supported long-GOP video, but just fine as a sort of a VHS replacement. But kind of once they got their teeth into that, MPEG-2 came along. MPEG-2 supports broadcast resolution at standard definition, supports both iframe only and long-GOP structures, different frame rates, YCRCB color sampling, lots of things, widescreen. And so MPEG-2 became the basis of pretty much all digital video until we went high def. You know, all deliverables, DVD, everything that wasn't kind of happening in the rarefied sort of like world of broadcast engineering was probably MPEG-2 encoded.
Yeah.
You know, And then come the late 90s, MPEG 4 came along. MPEG 4 brings some extra things to the party. And then in the noughties, kind of 2005 time, H.264, which again improves on MPEG 4, sometimes referred to as MPEG 4 part 10. And,
oh, really?
And now we're all talking about H.265, which doesn't really bring a lot more to the party, but it does expand the standards to cover 4K.
Is that HEVC?
HEVC, yeah, yeah. In fact, H.264 is sometimes referred to as AVC, sometimes referred to as MPEG 4 part 10, depending on the manufacturer. Apple typically refer to it as H.264. Panasonic typically refer to it as AVC. The standards bodies all call it MPEG 4 part 10. So here's so I've dropped that expression GOP, group of pictures, in a couple of times. And here's a little sort of representation of a group of pictures. And you can see at the start of the GOP there, we've got an iframe. And then what is that? Maybe 10 frames in, we've got another iframe. And between those iframes, we've got things called B frames and P frames. The P frames, P for predictive frames, they merely refer to macro blocks that were generated in the previous iframe. So the P frames are saying, okay, I know this macro block's moved from here to here, I'm just sending a vector, I'm basically predicting what the picture's going to be at that point. The B frames are even cleverer than that. The B frames essentially are P frames that are at liberty to look up the sequence and look down the sequence. They can say, okay, I don't have that macro block. It seems to have disappeared from when it was in that last iframe. But heavens, I can see it in the next iframe. There it is, right up the sequence there. So I'm going to refer to, it's a bi-directional predictive frame. It can refer to up and down the sequence. So
the B is for bi-directional.
Yes, yeah. So nice. we've got this sort of like sequence of frames, I, B, B, P, B, B, P, B, B, I. And that's kind of, a default kind of configuration. In PAL land, or I suppose in Europe, where we all 25-frame video, we typically have 12-frame GOPs. In America, you know, typically 30 frames a second or near 30 frames, they typically have 15-frame GOPs. But iframes, B-frames, and P-frames can occur wherever you like. If you had a particularly aggressive bit of video, the iframes might be bunched up an awful lot more. And when you have what we call variable bitrate encoding in DVDs, where some scenes will be given a lot more bandwidth than other scenes so as to maintain the overall data rate of the disk, then you might have a scene where the iframes are occurring an awful lot quicker than that. But for constant bitrate encoded material, where the encoder doesn't have that advantage of being able to encode it all in one go and then write it onto a disk, if the encoder is a transmission encoder or a satellite link encoder, something like that, it has to work in what we call a constant bitrate mode. And so it just has to kick them out as the standard requires. An iframe, a B-frame, a B-frame, a P-frame, et cetera, et cetera. So that
pattern, IBBP, is that a fixed pattern for a fixed thing, or is this just an illustration where there could be more Bs than Ps or more Ps than Bs?
So for example, there's only eight. This is a GOP of only 12 of only 10 of 9 frames here. So iframe to iframe is only 9 frames here. So this is an idealized version just for illustration.
Okay.
Typically, if you dig deep into Episode Engine or Aurora or Content Agent or wherever your favorite encoding machine is, if you dig deep enough, you can find the GOP structure that's going to be used for the bit of material you're about to encode. And typically, it's something like this. It's IBBP, BBP, BBP, BBI. It's that kind of thing. And a lot of this has been worked out mathematically or by testing lots of material to see what an optimal configuration is. But as I say, that's for constant bitrate encoded material. When you get to DVD authoring or Blu-ray authoring, you can take a few more liberties. And you can say, well, this is a very fast and furious scene here. The compression engine is at liberty to stick in a few more iframes if it wants. Whereas this sequence here is 30 seconds of a locked-off shot where nothing changes. We can be a bit, you know, we can take a few more liberties in terms of not having as many iframes. But that's what we call variable bitrate encoded material. So here's a little summary of iframes, P-frames, and B-frames. I'm not even going to read that because there's lots of words there.
You can freeze frame and read it for yourself.
Yeah, yeah. Or I suspect I stole it from Wikipedia. So, so what this gives us is this idea of the difference between editing codecs and transmission codecs. So a transmission codec, we'd like to leverage the extra quality for our bitrate that the long GOP gives us. The long GOP gives us an awful lot more bangs for our buck in terms of data rate versus picture quality. And we're not really concerned about the fact that we've spoiled an editable sequence. We're not really worried about the fact that this material would now be jolly hard to edit were it be dropped onto an Avid or a Final Cut timeline. But the iframe sequence, the editing codec, the much, much higher data rate codec is what's required if you're editing material. You know, no editor wants to be told you can only cut every 12 frames. Or, I know your Avid's slow to a crawl every time you made a non-iframe cut, but that's just the price you have to pay for working with long-GOP material. So that's why pretty much we edit short-GOP material, iframe-only material, but we acquire on camera and transmit and deliver long-GOP material. And that includes DVD and Blu-ray as well. So there's a bit of a rule of five. Or there was a rule of five when everything was MPEG-2. And so uncompressed standard definition video, if you forget about the audio, typically 250 megabits per second. When we've got that down to an iframe editing codec, so the Sony D10 codec, something like that, might be 50 megabits per second. For a long-GOP transmission codec, sitting on your transmission server, 10 megabits per second, very, very, very typical. And then we have another device called the statistical multiplexer, which basically allows us to go down another fivefold. So you watch your Freeview or your Sky or whatever at home, and typically each standard definition channel will be in the order of 2 megabits per second, all the way down from a 250 megabit original data rate.
Studio.
Yeah. This has got a bit better now with HD and H.264, which basically allows us to have about twice as much compression. And so there we go. Contemporary HD standards, MPEG-4 and H.264, or AVC, as it's sometimes called. And the thing that MPEG-4 brings to the party was that it allowed B frames and P frames to reference macro blocks across iframe boundaries. So they said, in MPEG-2, we have to kind of reboot every time we get to an iframe. We have to send a complete set of macro blocks at every iframe. Why do we have to do that? Why can't we just refer to macro blocks across iframe boundaries and say, this one hasn't changed for 10 seconds. Why do we have to resend it, you know? Just look yeah, back there kind of thing. And so that's what MPEG-4 brought to the party, the ability for macro blocks to exist across iframe boundaries. And then MPEG-4 Part 10, or H.264, that basically allows you to have variable size macro blocks. So for areas of the screen where there's not much going on at all, you can have a big 64x64, 32x32 macro block. Or for areas of the screen where you've got an awful lot going on, lots of detail, where you really want to concentrate your encoding performance, you can have little 4x4 macro blocks if you want to. And so it's kind of hard to see how much further discrete cosine-based transform codecs could go. So there's a screen grab of a typical kind of MPEG-4 Part 10, H.264 AVC codec, you know, where you can have variable size macro blocks, and you can have real tiny macro blocks around all the detail, and then, you know, variable size macro blocks as needed. And this
Absolutely.
This graph here shows us, for the same resolution material, for the same data rate, what the peak signal to noise ratio, which is a perceived quality measurement, gives us. So if we consider sort of maybe, what was that, like 2,200 kilobits per second or 2.2 megabits per second, very typical for an over-the-air transmission channel. And then we look at the PSNR values for different codecs. At our venerable old MPEG-2 codec, we would have about 26 dBs of PSNR. With a vanilla-flavored MPEG-4 codec, we'd have about, maybe 29 dBs of PSNR. And for our spiffy new MPEG-4 Part 10 AVC H.264 codec, 32 dBs of PSNR, all for the same data rate. And now, over the air, you know, 26 dBs is considered pretty minimum. You know, you want probably a bit better than that. 40 dBs is considered production quality. You can't tell it from uncompressed. And anything better than 32 is considered really quite spiffy, you know, just fine. So those 20 years worth of codec development, as we see going up here, you can see the benefits they've brought, you know. And the difference between 26 dBs of PSNR and 32 dBs of PSNR, 6 dBs, it's a doubling of perceived picture quality.
Yes, indeed.
Amazing. So then we have to kind of mention HEVC, H.265, you know, the new kid on the block. It's been around for a year or so now. And it's the kind of thing that doesn't bring an awful lot of new technology to the party, but it does open up the standard to 4K and 8K, and it'll be the way that people like Netflix deliver 4K movies over the web and stuff like that. It seems unlikely there'll be a physical disc format for it, but the new iPhone 6, actually that encodes in HEVC. So you know, it is starting to be used, just not very, very sort of common at the moment. So framing it. So what I've got here is I have got three off-air clips recorded off the Freeview multiplex. So you know, I recorded the MPEG. I recorded the whole multiplex. I didn't just record the MPEG 2 data, and then I extracted the channel from the multiplex, and they were all ones that had picture fault. You know, so an iframe. Typically, an iframe gets corrupted, and you see what happens after the corrupted iframe. And it's pretty much all the time the iframe gets corrupted, because if you think about it, the iframe is the biggest user, you know, the bulk of the data is iframes. All of the B's and the P's that come in between, they're quite modest by comparison. So what we've got here is we've got three off-air clips, University Challenge, clipper from MASH, because they've been rerunning MASH on one of the Freeview channels, and I love MASH, and a clip from a Only Connect, another BBC quiz show, my wife's favourite show. And so what I'll play them through, and you'll see what the corruption looks like at real-time playback. And then I've dropped them into a piece of software called Video Redo that allows you to frame through seeing what's an iframe and what's a B-frame and what's a P-frame. And so just watch this.
Nixon. That was Reagan. Finally, Suzanne Collins is the...
I've never even seen it done.
So that's the three clip samples, and here we are. Here's the University Challenge clip, and I'm just framing through. And if you look top left, it's hard to see, but it's showing us what's a B frame, P. Yeah. So we get to the corrupt frame there, and you can see it's the iframe that's been corrupted. The lower third of the frame is corrupted, and all the decompressor can do is show us what came before. Now we're continuing on through the GOP now, and we see some new material coming in, but just as kind of the guy moves and maybe the camera nudges a tiny bit, but we're still relying on manky old macro blocks from the previous GOP sequence. And it's not until we get to the next iframe that the decompressor is actually able to rebuild the picture. We're nearly there, but there we go. We hit an iframe and it's able to rebuild the picture. And that's very typical for a corrupt iframe. That's what it does to pictures. And so we should now, that'll then go to the clip from MASH. And this one's even more gross. I think pretty much the whole of the iframe has been corrupted in this one. So there we go. You can see Hawkeye from the previous GOP. And the new scene, we're probably only a quarter of it got through at the start. And as the scene goes on and the camera moves a bit and there's video noise and stuff, we are starting to see new macro blocks kind of being produced. But again, we're not going to see a completely new refresh frame until we get to the next iframe. So we're going through B frame, P frame, B frame, B frame, P frame, B frame, B frame, P frame. So at some point we'll get to an iframe, but as we see movement there, new macro blocks are built. But here we go. Here's the iframe, and we're now back in uncorrupted video territory. Now the next clip, it's a B frame that gets corrupted, and you can see that. That actually gets recovered from a darn sight quicker. It only takes two frames to recover from a corrupted B frame, because the next B frames, the next P frames, are able to refer back to bits of the sequence beyond the corruption. That they're able to look forward and backwards, up and down the sequence, you know, past the corruption. So it was a B frame that was corrupted. There we go. And literally, next B frame struggles, but then we're back into Happy Street again. So that kind of shows you what happens when get different types of corrupted frames. So let's stop that. That's another video clip from one of my children's school projects. but that's kind of very standard. You see that kind of whole thing going on, you know. And so there's another clip which really only makes sense if you're watching it live. So okay. I might drop that in at the very end of this podcast.
Good idea.
But basically what it is, it's a piece of video that I took off a DVD, so kind of quite good quality to start with. But then I ran it through several different codecs to see what effect codecs have on each other. And so
in concatenation, one after
in concatenation, exactly. And to avoid the accusation of, oh, you've just limited the data rate each time, basically on each re-encode, I've said, okay, I'm going to a higher data rate and I'm going to a more contemporary codec. So I think I start with MPEG 2, then I go to MPEG 4, then I go to H.264, then I go to ProRes, then I go to Sony XD Cam. So the codecs are getting better each time, and I double the data rate each time, so as to avoid that accusation of it's just lower data rate that's causing the problem. And by the fifth or sixth kind of pass through another compressor, the pictures really are getting quite indistinct, you know, loss of detail, and the audio is falling apart as well. So, you know, even if pictures look great, it really is the case that a compression encoder leaves residue within the pictures that then can interfere with subsequent decompression cycles. So that's my kind of little compression 101. This slide I've got up at the moment is just a pointer to what we're going to talk about next week. And this is a still frame from a test signal that I use a lot called the SRI visualizer. And part of the SRI visualizer is a compression stress grating, where you can see across the x-axis, across the top of the compression grating there, we've got lines of TV resolution. So I think when I grabbed this frame, I was the test signal generator was running in 720 mode, but it runs all the way up to 4K. And then we've got bits of perceived dynamic range down the side there. And so on an uncompressed signal with a good quality monitor, and most HD monitors aren't good enough for this, but with a good quality monitor, you can see a compression grating running all the way up to the top here. But when you pass it through a compressioning, and this grating moves as well. It's an animated grating, it's moving. You pass it through any kind of compression machine, and you immediately, even very high quality compression, you immediately start losing blocks up here. And you can see this has been through QuickTime, and you can see we've lost quite a lot of compression detail up here. And essentially, you can say, where have I lost it at high res in bit depth, and where have I lost it in lower res in bit depth? And with those two numbers, you can then convert that into a PSNR figure, a peak signal to noise ratio figure, which tells you, in a quantifiable fashion, how good the video is going to look. You couldn't tell that from camera pictures. You can't even tell it by running it into a Tektronix scope. That's kind of an impossible judgment to make. What you have to have is, well, firstly, you have to have access to the uncompressed video, and you have to have access to a very expensive compression meter, like a Rode & Schwarz compression meter. And then it can compare the uncompressed with the compressed video, and it can tell you, yes, we have a peak signal-to-noise ratio measurement from these pictures of 32 dBs or, you know, 26 dBs or whatever. And that's quite an expensive, quite an involved measurement to have to make. And an impossible measurement to make if you're talking to an engineer in Bulgaria who's looking at your satellite feed and saying, this doesn't look as good as it should, you know. You know, you have to be able to send him this signal and say, where does it run out on the top axis? Where does it run out on the vertical axis? And with those two numbers, I can then figure out how much that satellite encode compression decompression path is doing to me, you know. And I can go to my satellite provider and say, oi, you told me I'd have 30 dBs of PSNR. I'm only measuring 26. And they kind of look shamefaced because they assumed that you'd have to have access to the uncompressed video to be able to do that, but you don't have to. So that's my compression 101. That's all I've got to tell you.
Well, that's really that. It may be compressed, but it's expanded my understanding. How about that?
So, I mean, there are some unusual examples. Sony have always kind of sort of done better than everybody else, kind of thing. So, if you remember, Betacam SX was a digital format from the late 90s. Was kind of meant to be the cheap version of digital beta. In fact, first 3 years of Big Brother was all kind of shot and backed up on Beta SX. So, you know, that obviously was all edited on a SAN. I was the tech supervisor on that show. But for videotape, it was all recorded on Betacam SX. And Betacam SX used MPEG 2, but it used an iframe, b-frame GOP. So a short GOP and a two-frame GOP, which is kind of unusual, and it kind of gave Sony the benefit of being able to compress a bit more than just an iframe codec would allow. But because at that point VTRs did have holds, you know, several frames of videos worth of storage within them, you could recover the fact that you wanted to do frame accurate editing as well. Digital Betacam. Sony have never really given away how the codec works on and off tape. That's proprietary, as was HDCam. The only editing machine that could edit HDCam's data stream was Sony's own X-Pre editing workstation. So Sony have always kind of... And Sony have this new system called... let me go back to my blog. For contribution circuits called, what's it called? NSX, I think. I may have forgotten that. Here we are. NXL, the IP55 system, which allows you to pass four camera feeds over a gigabit connection, and four returns as well, because obviously the cameraman needs to see a viewfinder, or maybe the talent needs to see a prompter, you know. So this is bidirectional, four feeds, four up, four down, and over gigabit, which in itself is quite impressive, but it has a field of latency. So you know, you could run this into an OB truck and still it works very nicely.
Is this all part of AVB and all that good stuff?
Exactly,
as well.
Yeah. Although AVB tends to be, at the moment, what people talk about, AS67, the digital audio standard. Mm-hmm. But it does encompass this as well. But this is Sony's own proprietary system. Uses H.264 in some flavour, but they're not saying how. You know, it's a closed system. But, you know, good on Sony for kind of making high quality, high definition video over IP more usable for TV people, for people who want to plug up an OB truck and know that it'll work and not be meddling around with encoders and things like that.
Very, very interesting. And there are other compression types around. The word wavelet keeps popping into my head.
Yep. Wavelet is fundamentally different from DCT.
Yeah.
And I don't really know much about it other than it turns pixels straight into frequency domain measurements. I don't know much about it at all. That's the other contender, isn't it? And if you remember when we did our 4K 8K ultra high definition podcast, we talked a little bit about Professor Phil Willett's object based compression. So that's another thing to think about. But for the most part, everything we handle is DCT based. Well, not if you're working in digital cinema. So the DCI file format is JPEG 2000, and JPEG 2000 is wavelet based. But pretty much everything else the jobbing video engineer has to deal with starts off as DCT.
I think if you get your head around this, then you're not going to go far off for a while. Well, that's been absolutely fascinating. Thank you very much, Phil.
So our next we're going to take this a little bit further and talk about test and measurement for moving pictures. So being able to track down where compression is causing trouble and those kind of things.
Well, what, if anything, you can do about it? Excellent. Yeah. Thank you very much. Speak to you next time, then.
Jolly good. I'll see you soon, chap.
Yeah.